إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. أما بعد، فإن خير الحديث كتاب الله تعالى، وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. All praise and thanks belong to Allah, the Most High, the Most Merciful. We thank Him and we seek His help and aid and ask Him to forgive us and protect us from the evil of ourselves and the sins that we commit. Indeed, whosoever Allah guides, no one can lead astray. And whosoever Allah leads astray, no one can guide. And I bear witness that there is no one worthy of worship except Allah alone, and that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is His slave and messenger. The best of speech is the book of Allah, and the best of guidance is the guidance of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the worst of religious matters are those that are innovated. And every religious innovation is a bid'ah, and every bid'ah is misguidance, and every misguidance will be in hellfire. We begin by praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and thanking Him. Thanking Him for all the ni'mas that He had given us and continues to give us. And in particular, thanking Him for the ni'mah of Ramadan that we just left. That opportunity, that unique opportunity in the year where we get closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for a lot of us in ways that was not available to us for the rest of the year. And the common question that comes after Ramadan is, what have we learned from it? And can we maintain the spirit of Ramadan after Ramadan? Now the question here is not about maintaining the same rhythm and intensity of Ramadan after Ramadan, because that is not realistic. And in fact, we can say that even that is not from the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that he would maintain the same intensity and devotion and dedication outside Ramadan as it was inside Ramadan. Ramadan is a special month, where even him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would increase his worship in very noticeable ways. But it's also the case that the time that comes after Ramadan, the days and the weeks and months of after Ramadan, must also reflect and exhibit something that we have learned in Ramadan. And so this khutbah bi-idhnillah is about how to maintain, or what does it mean to maintain the spirit of Ramadan after the month of Ramadan, and how can we do it? If you think about Ramadan and all of its glory and all of its blessings and all the rahmah that is in it, and try to break down why was that there, you inshallah you will be able to reduce it to at least three reasons. One is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the second is your own taqwa. And the third is al-ijtima'u ala ta'a, where you gather upon the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. These three. And that if we pay attention to these three after Ramadan, that momentum that we created in Ramadan can inshallah be maintained to one degree or another. The first is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is Allah who blessed us in Ramadan. Allah who gave us the strength in it. Allah gave us the tawfiq. Allah gave us the hidayah. Allah opened the gates of Jannah and closed the gates of hellfire. It is Allah who made it possible. So after Ramadan, we must not rely upon ourselves thinking that we can do it on our own. We must immediately connect ourselves to Allah, rely upon Him, and ask Him for hidayah, for continued support, and not to misguide us after he had guided us, not to close our hearts after he had opened them, not to make our eyes blind after we could see, not to take from us the sweetness of iman after we were able to taste this, to taste it, not to deprive our tongues from the sweetness of the Quran after we were able to taste it. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, رَبَّنَا لَا تُزِغْ قُلُوبَنَا بَعْدَ إِذْ هَدَيْتَنَا وَهَبْ لَنَا مِنْ لَدُنْكَ رَحْمَةً إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ الْوَهَّابُ. Allah says in the Quran, on the tongue of the pious and the learned, Ya Allah, do not cause our hearts to go astray after you have guided us. That is, anyone who loves Allah, who fears Allah and wants to be close to Him, knows that his heart is in the hand of who? Not in his own hand, not in the hands of his family or his superiors. It is only in the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to often say, Allahumma ya muqallib al-qulub, thabbit qalbi ala deenik. Oh ya Allah, turner of the hearts, establish, fix my heart upon your religion. And that ayah is asking exactly for the same thing. Ya Allah, after you have guided us, don't let our hearts go astray. Don't let us be lost in the dunya. Don't let us be engulfed by its desire. La, ya Allah, give us rahmah, give us guidance. Strengthen our heart, because you're the giver of hidayah. One of the dua of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam that he used to seek refuge in Allah from al-hawr after al-kawr, from weakness after strength, weakness of iman after the strength of iman, weakness of in reading the Quran after strength in reading the Quran, weakness in ibadah after strength in ibadah, distance from Allah after you are so close to Him, meaning, Ya Allah, protect me, especially now that my mortal enemy is free and is out to get me and is out to undermine everything that I've done and built in Ramadan. Ya Allah, protect me with your protection after Ramadan. So must not forget your dua all the time, in the morning and in the evening, for yourself, for your family, for your children, and for the Ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Ya Allah, help us, grant us tawakkul upon you, grant us hidayah, protect us from your enemy. So to keep asking Allah and rely upon Him, because without Him, we will never be able to maintain anything after Ramadan, or we never be able to learn anything in it or after it. So the first thing is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The second thing that helped us in Ramadan is our taqwa. Ramadan was there to build up this taqwa. How close we are to Allah, how conscious we are of Him, how much we love Him and how much we fear Him. And you could see in Ramadan that when you perform a ibadah, it strengthens your iman. It strengthens your devotion. It brings you closer to Allah. And one ibadah gives birth to another ibadah. One strength of iman leads to a higher rank of iman. The more that you worship Allah, the more that Allah will send you to higher ranks of worship and taqwa and obedience. So the way to maintain some momentum after Ramadan and not neglect and lose the lessons of Ramadan is to maintain your taqwa and to maintain your ibadah. And now you have to go and inspect, what is it that I was doing in Ramadan? And how can I maintain it in a rhythm that allows me to be consistent, not sporadic, consistent. Every day I'm gonna schedule for myself and also for my family, wherever that is applicable. For my family, a ibadah that will keep us all close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Think about fasting. You used to fast, and fasting has this incredible effect on you, internally and externally. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, in a hadith that I'm sure that you know, he said that is in Muslim, that the one who fasts Ramadan and follows it by 6 days of Shawwal, it will be as if he fasted the entire year. You think about it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam want you, without an obligation, they want you to maintain the ibadah of fasting after Ramadan. So they give you that incentive. He tells you fast 6 more days. Consecutive or separate, as long as they are in Shawwal. And it will be counted as if you have fasted the entire year for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Here you find that Allah Azza wa Jal extends this ibadah of fasting beyond Ramadan. And you can do more about it. You can do 3 days every month. You can do Mondays. You can do Thursdays. And if you make it part of your rhythm, part of your routine, it'll become part of you bi-idhnillah. And you will feel its effect. You've been reading the Quran throughout the month of Ramadan, listening to it and reading it. Can you maintain this after Ramadan? Yes. And to be deprived of the words of Allah in your life is to be deprived of barakah. Barakah in your tongue, in your eyes, in your heart, in your body, in your house, for your children, for your spouse. When the words of Allah Azza wa Jal are deserted, boycotted in a sense, we lose barakah. We lose ikhlas, we lose sincerity, we lose peace. Can you make the Quran a daily part of your life? You can, bi-idhnillah. If you just plan, and if you make dua, Ya Allah, help me to do it. You can plan that as soon as you wake up, before Fajr, after Fajr, before you go to bed, I'm going to read 2, 3, 5 pages of the Quran, and I'm going to make this my routine. I'm not going to sleep without doing this. I'm not going to go to work or school or go out or check anything online before doing this. If you make that an intention and you insist upon it, it will be part of your life. And you will soon, inshallah, see its effect because you're consistently bringing Allah and His words into your life. The rest of your ibadah, your salah, and especially salah at night, so the 5 daily obligatory prayers, and also your ibadah at night. One essential feature of Ramadan is that we use to pray at night qiyam. We're not going to pray for an hour or a half or 2 hours. Some of us are not going to do that. But we can give Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala 10 minutes. 2 rak'ahs or 4 rak'ahs, 10 minutes, 15 minutes. Before we go to bed. Or before Fajr, after we wake up and before Fajr. We can do this inshallah. And with consistency, you'll find that your relationship with Allah has improved. And your dependence, anxiety about the dunya has declined. And your heart feels better. And your mind is focused. And you're more inclined to obey Allah and stay away from the haram. And the last thing about that point that I want to say is that we also need to think about seeking knowledge. The ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam should be the ummah of knowledge, the ummah of ilm. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, طلب العلم فريضة على كل مسلم. Seeking knowledge is an obligation on every Muslim. So here I want to recommend, since we do have time, inshallah, and the summer presents us with ample opportunity to spend on, inshallah, beneficial and sometimes non-beneficial activities. Why don't we read? Why don't we seek knowledge? Why don't we look for the study circles and lectures and lessons in the houses of Allah and we visit them? Because A, it's an obligation on us to read our, to learn our religion. Second of all, the religious literacy in the ummah of Muhammad has to increase. We have to know our religion better, to know what is right and what is wrong. So we're not fooled by the shaitan or the helpers of the shaitan. So we know our path clear to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So let us read and encourage our children to read. Let's pick a book or two and say, I'm going to finish this summer. And beneficial book, if it brings you closer to Allah, then it's good. If it benefits you in this dunya, it's good. But fill your time with something beneficial. And reading is one of the best things that you can do. So let us read and let us increase our knowledge. And by it come closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم فاستغفروه. الحمد لله رب العالمين حمدا كثيرا طيبا مباركا فيه، وأصلي وأسلم على رسوله محمد صلى الله عليه وآله وصحبه وسلم. أما بعد، the third point is gathering upon the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, doing it in a collective, in a group. We've done that in Ramadan. We all fasted together. We came to pray together. We came for Eid together. And you see that one of the objectives of the Sharia, look at all the obligations, by the way. Just sit back and contemplate all the obligations of Allah. One of the main objectives of the Sharia is to bring Muslims together on the obedience of Allah Azza wa Jal. Think of fastings, think of salah in the masjid, think of Jum'ah, think of Hajj, think of Zakah. We're doing it as a group. Why? Because we are stronger together. Allah Azza wa Jal says in the Quran, وَأَقِيمُوا الصَّلَاةَ وَآتُوا الزَّكَاةَ وَارْكَعُوا مَعَ الرَّاكِعِينَ. Establish the salah. Give the zakah and make ruku', bow with those who are bowing. Not just by yourself, but seek the company of those who are bowing to Allah Azza wa Jal. Humbly submitting themselves to Allah, and you be with them. Why? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam said in the hadith, الشَّيْطَانُ مَعَ الْوَاحِدِ وَهُوَ مِنَ الْإِثْنَيْنِ أَبْعَدِ. He says the shaitan will be with the solitary individual and he will be further away from a couple. And he says in the hadith, إِنَّمَا يَأْكُلُ الذِّئْبُ مِنَ الْغَنَمِ الْقَاصِيَةِ. He says the wolf is gonna eat only the solitary sheep, the one that is standing by itself, away from the group, because it's vulnerable. You see this in the animal kingdom. When they're together, they're stronger. And when they're isolated, they're weak. And Allah wants you to be strong. So here you have to seek the company of those who fear Allah and love Allah. And where is this? In the houses of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You have to frequent the masjid. Brothers and sisters, you have to frequent the masjid. Come closer to the masjid and to the people on the masjid. Let the example of the people in it strengthen you, and let your example strengthen them. Let both of you elevate each other so that you come closer to Allah Azza wa Jal. You'll find that the best spots in your city are not the most expensive spots, are not the malls, are not the parks. Some of these places are halal to go. You can go to them. I'm talking about the best spots in your city are the houses of Allah Azza wa Jal. How dear is your house to you? This is the house of the one that we should love more than ourselves, Allah Azza wa Jal. How dear is this house to you? So you should come to it and spend time in it and improve it and maintain it and invite others to it. And if you do that, bi-idhnillah, you will find that your iman will be strong. And it will climb. And the iman of your family will be strong. And it will also increase. Iman, brothers and sisters, needs to be nurtured. Needs to be protected. And if we don't do it, we will lose it. And it's a sad thing that we should lose all the beautiful things that we had in Ramadan and forget about them till the next Ramadan, where we would need to rediscover them again. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the most merciful, to make us of those who were forgiven in the month of Ramadan. Ya Allah, make us of those whose their obedience was accepted in the month of Ramadan. And if we have done anything in it, Ya Rabbal Alameen, that upsets you, forgive that, Ya Rabbal Alameen. Ya Allah, accept the good things that we have done in Ramadan. Accept our ibadah in the month of Ramadan. Accept our ta'at in the month of Ramadan. Ya Rabbal Alameen, preserve us and protect us till the coming Ramadan. Ya Allah, forgive us what is between the two Ramadans. Ya Allah, help us to maintain the momentum that we've created in the month of Ramadan. Help us to stay close to you and to your house and to your book and to calling upon you and making frequent dua to you, Ya Rabbal Alameen. And keep us away from harm and keep us away from sin, Ya Arhamar Rahimeen. Ya Allah, strengthen our iman. Ya Rabbal Alameen, increase iman in our hearts. Increase that love that we have for you in our hearts. And increase the love that we have for your Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in our hearts, Ya Rabbal Alameen. يا Ya Allah, forgive us all of our sins, that which we know about and that which we do not know about. And forgive the Ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And give them strength, Ya Arham al-Rahimeen, and unite them upon the truth. Allahumma atina fi dunya hasana, wa fil akhirati hasana, wa qina azab al-nar. Allahumma inna nas'aluka al-jannata wa ma qarraba ilayha min qawlin wa amal. Wa na'udhu bika min al-nar wa ma qarraba ilayha min qawlin wa amal. Wa nas'aluka min khayri ma sa'alaka abduka Muhammadun sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Wa na'udhu bika من شر ما استعاذك منه عبدك محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. اللهم تقبل منا طاعاتنا في رمضان. اللهم تقبل منا طاعاتنا في رمضان. اللهم تقبل منا طاعاتنا في رمضان. واغفر لنا ما كان فيه من الزلل والمعاصي رب العالمين. اللهم وفقنا اللهم وفقنا لرمضان القادم، واحفظنا فيما بينه وبين رمضان الفائت رب العالمين. اللهم احفظنا من الزلل والخطأ والمعاصي رب العالمين. واغفر اللهم لنا مغفرة واسعة من الذنوب كلها ما علمنا منها وما لم نعلم. واغفر اللهم لأمة محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. اللهم اجمع أمة محمد على ما تحب وترضى. اللهم واحفظهم مما يسخطك رب العالمين. اللهم واجعلهم قوة على من عاداهم يا أرحم الراحمين يا عزيز يا حكيم. اللهم يا مقلب القلوب ثبت قلوبنا على دينك. اللهم يا مصرف القلوب صرف قلوبنا على طاعتك. يا حي يا قيوم برحمتك نستغيث، أصلح لنا شأننا كله ولا تكلنا إلى أنفسنا طرفة عين، وأقم الصلاة.